morning. Welcome to the final day of the National Network for Safe Communities' second national conference. Today's session will end at 5 p.m. We will once again provide lunch for you in the student dining hall at 1 p.m. A couple of notes before we get started. At the close of the conference, if you could please dispose of your name badges at the registration desk where you first came in. Secondly, if you have misplaced any of your personal items, please make sure you visit one of the staff members and we will help you search for your item in our lost and found. Our plenary this morning is entitled Reconciliation, Truth-Telling, and the National Initiative for Building Community Trust and Justice. Our guest speakers include David Kennedy, Director of the National Network for Safe Communities, Catherine Dark Schmidt, Policy Advisor to the Assistant Attorney General for the Office of Justice Programs. She specializes in the implementation and evaluation of federal grant programs to support state and local law enforcement and community-based organizations. Tom Tyler is the Macklin Fleming Professor at Law and Professor of Psychology at Yale Law School. His research explores the role of judgments about the justice or injustice of group procedures in shaping legitimacy, compliance, and cooperation. Tracie Keesee is the project director of the National Initiative for Building Community Trust and Justice at the National Network. She is a 25-year veteran of the Denver Police Department and the co-founder and director for the research partnerships for the Center for Policing Equity. Finally, Priscilla Hayner, who is currently an independent expert on transitional justice. She was a co-founder of the International Center for Transitional Justice and continues to work on a wide range of transitional justice issues with a current focus on peace negotiations. Please join me in welcoming our panel.
Thanks, Kevin. And also, welcome back. Yesterday was great, and we will try to keep that tradition going. So much of yesterday's conversation, and of course, much of what we're all thinking about in all of our orbits these days, is that the country is suddenly in a very special and different place with respect to police community relations issues. We really ought to expand that to criminal justice community issues and not just to troubled African American neighborhoods, but to other sorts of neighborhoods and populations. But we all also know that first among equals in this moment are the police and often very angry, very disenchanted African American neighborhoods. And the Justice Department has framed a really generationally significant initiative to take on exactly that. I've been doing this for 30 some years, and it is the most significant and I truly believe high potential such project that the federal government has launched in all of that time. It, in fact, predates Ferguson, and the salience of all this has, of course, risen enormously because of Ferguson and what has come after, but justice was in motion on this already. And it, in fact, goes back to, as Jeremy mentioned yesterday, Jeremy Travis, the work that the president and the attorney general did after the Trayvon Martin verdict was handed down. And in each case, in very careful and responsible but heartfelt ways, the president and then attorney general said, the nation has to do something about violence being directed against young black men and the feeling, the experience of their communities around that issue. And it's now a matter of record that President Travis went to the Justice Department shortly after that and I'm going to say really represented this community and said, on the ground at the state and local level, in cities and neighborhoods all across the country, really good people have been doing very serious work around these issues for a very long time. And important things have been learned about the problem and about some very promising ways of framing the problem and actually taking concrete action, and urged the administration to look at those framings, look at those responses and interventions, and urge them to give them significant national support. Carol Mason, who was with us here yesterday, put together a very high-level federal interagency group that considered that outreach. And then we had a long period of radio silence, which turned out to be because they were taking the idea very seriously. And in April of last year, at the Ford Foundation here in New York City, Justice announced a solicitation for what it came to call, was calling then, the National Institute for Building Community Trust and Justice. And I am very happy to say that after a long period of very careful consideration of what that might actually represent, and a long engagement with what I will say with considerable authority and emphasis is the most intricate and demanding bid that, in my experience, the Justice Department has ever put out, a consortium of folks you see here and for whom we will speak here because we're not all present today, we're given the opportunity to do this work. So the consortium operating here is the National Network for Safe Communities, Tom Tyler and Tracie Mears representing Yale Law School and with a very special focus on procedural justice and legitimacy. Philip Atiba Goff, who you met yesterday and who I hope made his plane, who is our national expert on both the theory and the application of ideas of implicit bias. The Urban Institute in Washington, D.C., not represented here in a central research and technical assistance role, and the National Institute or the national initiative is being co-administered by those groups in real-time cooperation with the Justice Department. So let me sketch what it is. And everybody in this room understands that the nature of the relationship between the public and the police is central. We now know for a fact that that is centrally connected not only to public opinion and feelings about the acceptability or unacceptability of those relationships, but we now know that it is directly connected to compliance with the law, to whether crime goes up or down, particularly in the most troubled neighborhoods. The research is showing very clearly that especially in the most historically troubled neighborhoods, there is a very strong connection between feelings of legitimacy toward law enforcement and levels of crime. We know that it is centrally connected with voluntary compliance with the law or the lack thereof. We know from research, especially that Tom and Tracie and their community has done, that there is much less distinction than one would think between the attitudes of folks we think of as serious offenders toward the law and other folks toward the law. The survey research on this is fascinating, and it says something very close to serious violent offenders and others actually have pretty much the same feelings toward the law. They respect it. The big difference is that serious violent offenders don't respect the police. And there's now good reason to believe that as that respect goes up, crime goes down. I think there are folks from the Center for Court Innovation here who have shown that same basic connection when judges treat defendants better, they comply better as time goes forward. So this is not the sort of public relations, community relations issue that we thought it was for a very long time. It goes directly to the safety of neighborhoods, to whether we produce that safety through voluntary compliance or by arresting and prosecuting and locking people up. It is as material as it can get. And I personally spend a lot of time feeling not very bright. We should have seen this a long time ago. But in the core violence prevention work of which I've been a part, we see routinely situations in which young men know who have killed their friends. And we now understand, we always understood, that in those situations they have two perfectly substitutable choices. They can call 911, they can work with the police, they can work with prosecutors, and that person can, on a good day, be brought to justice. Or they can get a gun in their friends and they can go deal with it with themselves. And we want people to choose door number one. And not choosing door number two, in many cases, comes down directly to the relationships, to the perceptions on both sides. And the National Initiative for Building Community Trust and Justice is designed centrally at showing that we can do better here. Let me sketch it structurally very quickly, and then I'll bring in the other members of the panel. It's a 3-year project. Work on the ground will begin in year 2016. This year has been and will continue to be a setup year. The focused work in cities to show we hope and expect that we can in fact make real progress in these areas will be done in what was 5 and became 6 cities across the country. A lot of the time up until now has been spent on site selection, and the sites as they arrived are Fort Worth, Texas, Stockton, California, Minneapolis, Minnesota, Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, and I'm always Birmingham and Gary, Indiana. I do this every single time. It's not always the same cities. Right, it's just always something. This is why we have partnerships. We've been making site visits in all of those places, and the good news on this has been there is tremendous receptivity and excitement in all of those places. One of the things we've been afraid of, and it's a fear of a perception, not a fear of a reality, is that this would be seen as a kind of indictment and condemnation of those places. That this is explicitly or implicitly saying, we want to work with all of you because you are in such trouble that you need us. And in fact, it was exactly the opposite. This is a generational, multi-generational opportunity to show the nation that we can do a lot better in these areas, and we are absolutely committed to doing it. And what we went looking for was a sampling of kind of common sense variation across national geography and city size and that sort of thing, but most fundamentally, cities that we knew out of our own experience and out of some very careful scrutiny would be wonderful partners. We wanted community capacity and commitment. We wanted law enforcement capacity and commitment. We wanted genuine commitment from local government. And we wanted that intangible fervor that says, you know, we're as excited about this as all of you are, and we found that, and so this is not the we're the government here to help you routine than it might otherwise be. So we're just getting started on the ground in these places. The DOJ framing on this said not just police, but also elements of law enforcement. So we're thinking about prosecution and corrections and the bench and all that sort of thing. It said a range of important communities. So African American, Latino, we added Native American, victims of crime, especially victims of domestic violence and sexual assault, youth, and the LGBTQI community. And so we're going to be looking for ways to extend our focus in those places. And DOJ said, we believe from looking at the evidence base and the sort of state of the art and the state of the field, that there are three particular ways in which we want to make progress on the ground. And we believe that working with all of those partners on enhancing procedural justice is important, that working on implicit bias is important, and that finding ways to do frank reconciliation work is important. And so what we're doing right now is figuring out a range of interventions in all of those areas that we will begin deciding on and working on with all of those cities. There is research that will be done to we hope show that things are in fact moving. There is a clearinghouse and kind of public conversation and translation element, and the website that begins that is up right now, and Tracie will talk about that. But that is the table now set for this extraordinarily important work. And what Justice encouraged us also to do, and what we will absolutely do, is if and as decisions get made, work gets done, sort of results and insights start to present themselves, we will collectively be moving that out to everybody and anybody who wants it. And I think Catherine will talk about her other role within Justice, which is supporting and facilitating non-national initiative sites in exactly this way. So let me stop there, and Catherine.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. Thank you for being here this morning. My name is Catherine Dark from the Office of Justice Programs, and I'm very pleased to be on this panel to speak a little bit about how, as David says, the table was set at the Department of Justice to engage in this work in a very meaningful way, and a way which is different than other initiatives that have come from the Department of Justice under prior administrations. There was clearly a mandate for myself and my colleagues at DOJ to tackle this, to engage the field in tackling this, because this is an administration priority from the president to former General Holder and now Attorney General Lynch. It was very clear to us that our job is to make sure that there are opportunities and equities and ladders within our community that make sure that everyone has access to the roles and the rights that they should have by virtue of the fact that they are citizens of this country. The Department of Justice, particularly my branch of it, the Office of Justice Programs, many of you may know because of our role as a funder. We're primarily a grant-making organization at the Department of Justice to the tune of about $2 billion a year. And that is a very important function because it helps us to help state and local law enforcement access resources that you need to do your jobs effectively and efficiently. But we have another important job to which David alluded, and that is to seed and then help replicate and disseminate knowledge in the field of criminal justice and public safety so that the investments that we make and the investments that you are making are leveraged and used across the country rather than being siloed in a particular place and then 18 months later reinvented somewhere else in slightly similar circumstances. So the focus of the national initiative is not only to do this very important work on the ground that David's talking about, but it is also to build knowledge and then to disseminate knowledge so that communities who are part of the initiative now as part of the six first cohort cities, perhaps cohort cities that will follow in future years, but also communities that are engaged from the outside watching this develop have access to these kinds of resources. I am very pleased to be part of this partnership. This was a competition during the radio silence that David talked about. We were trying to craft a solicitation that would take these really big ideas and fit them into our 30-page max, double column, 10-point Roman font, one-inch margin sort of format that we have to use when we want to start a conversation about big ideas. But it was a discretionary solicitation, and we laid out what was important to us to accomplish, and David spoke about those highlights in terms of procedural justice and implicit bias and reconciliation, where there was starting to be some practical experience in the field, but also now a couple decades of research on what is working. We wanted to see how those could be blended together, and we wanted to also bring in other parts of our work and your work in public safety that have a strong evidence base, things like how we work with victims of crime and what it means to deliver trauma-informed services, and what happens when the perpetrators of crime are also victims of crime and how that impacts their experiences in the criminal justice system and how that should impact how we approach them. So as David said, it was admittedly complicated and the font was somewhat small, but there was a lot we wanted to say, and we put it out in the field and received competitive proposals back and did our usual peer review by very smart people sitting around a table dissecting the ideas that came forward. And this collaboration here that was funded was very interesting because it really did bring together people who had developed the expertise in the field in these issues. But it also mirrored so nicely the way the initiative had been put together from the department. You may be used to a department that is somewhat compartmentalized, and the Bureau of Justice Assistance is putting out a solicitation, and the COPS office is putting out a solicitation, and the OVW is putting out a solicitation, and ne'er the three shall meet. But in this case, we were very deliberate in our conversations with each other so that all the components that had a stake in this were represented. And they all came to the table, and some of them brought money to the table, and some of them brought expertise to the table. So from the federal side, if you had a panel of us, it would be this same breadth, which makes this very interesting and exciting work to do on the federal level. So I look forward to hearing what the other panelists have to say about how they are beginning to develop this work in the field. And again, thank you for your time this morning.
Well, good morning. I'm Tom Tyler. And David did a very nice job laying out the framework of the initiative, and Catherine explained more about the federal role. So I will just say a few things to build on what David and Catherine said. I want to begin by agreeing with David Kennedy. Across this room, we have many people in policing and many different opinions probably about what has worked and not worked in the last 30 years, what's a good practice, what's a good policy, what's a bad idea for policing in the future. But I think what we would probably all agree is that policing is open for discussion in a way that it hasn't been since an earlier period in the 60s and 70s when the Kerner Report was written. Suddenly, a lot of assumptions about policing are open for discussion. And in particular, from our point of view, there's been an amazing change in the focus of a lot of what that discussion is about. If you had gone to almost any meeting of police leaders 10 or 15 years ago, there would have been one primary topic of discussion, and that's crime control. Policing discussions, for example, the National Academy of Sciences report in 2004 focused on the ability to control crime and whether the police were following the law. So today, we find the task force in their recent report saying that public trust and confidence in the police is the first pillar of policing. Now that idea is an idea that was only hinted at in the 2004 National Academy of Sciences report, But suddenly now it's the first pillar of policing. Well, why is that? One of the things that's clear is that for whatever reason, crime has really declined amazingly in the last 30 years. And police professionalism has gone up in all sorts of ways. But if we look at the way the public views the police, we see that that is not reflected in public views of trust and confidence in the police. If you look at a national survey, there just was one out this month, 52% of adult Americans expressed trust and confidence in the police and their community. If you went back 20 or 30 years, you would find 52% of Americans expressed trust and confidence in the police. Although there's been minor variation over the years, basically, these accomplishments have not translated into a better relationship between the police and the community, and as David mentioned, in particular, a better relationship between the police and minority communities. So there's been a change in focus to try to understand this paradox, and in particular, to ask the question, what is it that leads people in a particular community to trust their police force? If it's not crime reduction, if it's not that the police are behaving lawfully, what is it? Fortunately, we have a lot of research that tells us and gives us a very consistent answer about the police, and interestingly, a very similar consistent answer about the courts. People want to feel that the authorities they're dealing with are acting fairly. They're using procedures to exercise their authority that people understand to be fair. We can go into a lot of depth about what that means based upon research, but I think a simple way to put it is people want to see that the police are making decisions fairly. They want to feel that they're being treated fairly by the police. So great, we actually have a lot to tell the interested policing community about how to address this question of building trust and confidence. We also, as David mentioned, have a body of research that shows how important this is, that links these feelings of trust and confidence to compliance, that links them to cooperation, all sorts of problems that are traditionally of concern, like snitching. We know how to improve those behaviors to benefit the police in different communities. And I would emphasize again a point that David made, that this is true for three key constituencies of the police. It's true for the public in general, the very large proportion of most communities that seldom actually deal with the police, but when they do deal with the police, for example, when being asked to support the police, they think about the police through a procedural justice framework. It's true of most of the people in high crime communities. One of the really important findings of network research, which will be discussed in the next panel, is that even in a highly violent community, about 6% of the people in that community are violent, and we can identify those people and separate them out. We know who they are. That means we can think about a general policy of undangerousness. We can think about the 90%+ of the community that would be willing to cooperate and help the police. Those people are also found to be very sensitive to procedural justice. And finally, as David said, even hardcore criminals who are involved in violent crime, who are involved in drug crime, are found to be responsive to whether they get fair treatment in terms of their behavior in relationship to the police and the law. So we have a really strong research base. I, again, as David did, would like to compliment the Department of Justice and its various agencies. They realized that. They recognized that. They brought us to Washington. Tracie Mears and I came from Yale to represent a procedural justice point of view. Phil Goff from the Center for Policing Equity, along with Tracie Keesee to represent implicit bias. David Kennedy to represent race and reconciliation. So the Department of Justice brought together people that they had identified as people who had a research base and a theoretical base for making suggestions about what would actually work in trying to address confidence issues. I'm very impressed by the fact that the Department of Justice thought about research as a basis for picking programs to support. I think we're all really excited that when they did that, they thought we were the leaders of research, and we're happy to agree with them. We think we're the leaders of research also. But the point is that they gave us an opportunity to present a proposal. As David said, that proposal is designed to implement new strategies based upon these three models in 6 target communities. We are also, as Catherine said, we're going to use this as an opportunity to try to disseminate all of the information that we can gather from the literature and from these efforts to give to anybody who wants it. And third, we are going to do research to demonstrate that, in fact, the belief in these ideas is supported by research on their effect in these different communities. So we have an ambitious goal. I think it's a goal that we are confident we'll be able to meet. And I would just say that I think this is a real opportunity for this initiative, but also more broadly, to rethink, rediscuss what policing should look like in the 21st century.
It's always difficult following you. Good morning. One more time, good morning. My name is Tracie Keesee, and I'm the project director for the National Initiative for Building Community Trust and Justice, and I recognize that that is a mouthful. So those of us at the table have just gone to calling ourselves the NI. It looks really good on t-shirts, and you can hashtag NI, which I think is pretty cool. I want to just kind of back us up just a little bit and talk about some of the pieces, but how they all come together under the National Initiative Project itself. As David has so aptly framed, and Catherine has given the backstory, and Tom has certainly led us into the number of reasons why procedural justice, and there is a time now to have these deeper conversations about law enforcement, are very important. The National Initiative itself is built on the three pillars, and the three pillars that you heard yesterday, and those that you are gonna hear from this panel today, of procedural justice, implicit bias, and reconciliation, or race and reconciliation. The implicit bias piece, which all of you so aptly met Philip Atiba-Goff yesterday when he ran out to catch his plane, but the notion of implicit bias is one of which is an unconscious psychological process that aids us in making very quick stereotypical connections of groups. The outcomes of those stereotypical connections can be deadly in some cases. In some cases, it can also help us. For those of us that are in law enforcement, the number one thing that scares us is that we talk about being a racist or racism. It is that chilling conversation in the room. It is that elephant in the room. And one of the things I think for me that led me to want to be a part of this was this was the opportunity to get at the historical pieces of what underlies communities of color today. And that is the intersection of race and policing. And how does it impact those interactions? And I think so there are pieces that we all come to the table with that will not only complement one another very well, but will also, I think, as others have also said, allow us to really find out and discover new things that we didn't know. Also, a part of the team that is not here with us is the Urban Institute, which was mentioned briefly. The Urban Institute has this incredible role of measuring how we are doing with this type of work and then telling the story of each of our 6 cities. They also have a tremendous lift in going out into each of those 6 communities and to begin to do survey work to, one, give us a baseline, but to interact and to do interviews about relationships and trust. I know yesterday there were several panels that had talked about the weariness and the leeriness of communities of color and us coming in again and saying, you know, we're the government, we're here to help you. One of the things that I think struck me as we move forward with this project is that although those communities may seem weary and they may be vocal, one thing they are not is helpless, and they have not given up. And so I think that it really behooves us to do not only an incredible job with this opportunity, to be very mindful of folks that have really over decades have come to us over and over again asking for our help and making sure this is something that we create that is sustainable. So I know for the national initiative for us, that is a big piece of that as well. Another portion of the national initiative programmatic pieces is the trustinjustice.org website, and it's just as easy as that. It's trustinjustice.org. But what makes this website so unique is our relationship with OJP, the Office of Justice Programs, and the Diagnostic Center. What this allows those who come to the website to do is to actually go in and put in those pieces that you may have questions about or wondering if there's technical assistance or training available, whether it's about community policing, whether it's about leadership, whether it's about implicit bias training, to go into our website and to put that information in. And then OJP will do a triage. And this whole piece of this is free. And this is the part that I think the community really sits up to take notice. Something that has often been directed towards law enforcement is something that is also now available to community at large. It allows them to go in and to ask questions about whether, again, it's community policing, whether it's about how do I interact with law enforcement. OJP will do a triage, and they immediately reach out to those who are making the request, and they begin to match them with technical assistance with little and no cost. We find that that is going to be another key component to our success as well. The other few programmatic pieces that we know will be very vitally important, so it's not just the transparency of the work that we do, that we have all of this highlighted, but it's what's happening now here, the 2 days that you all have been together. And that's the exchange of information and the exchange of ideas and hearing those things that work and hearing those things that do not work. Our 6 cities are represented in the conference, proudly so, and you know, some they're spread all out, but Chief Roper and other chiefs, as well as other of our, what we call them, our NI partners on the ground, are here because they want to hear what everyone else is doing and prepare themselves for what those outcomes may look like. So again, we're thankful that we have this opportunity not just to highlight the national network, but also to allow those to have that sort of peer-to-peer exchange. A couple of final components of that will also, there will be what we consider to be informational pieces or papers that are written, and not only on the scholarly side, but those pieces that you'll be allowed, will allow you all to go back and to take them and to say what happens in Birmingham may be something for us to look at in another location. So I think those are the other pieces that we're extremely proud of. One of the things that really makes the national initiative different, and certainly no disrespect to historical things with DOJ, is those of us who've been in law enforcement for a very long time, whenever we heard the word reform, we would cringe. Because reform to us, or at least I could say to me, meant that was something that was going to be done to you and not with you. The national initiative is very different in that respect, in that as we move and we work with the communities and the chiefs and the departments on the ground, they have the opportunity and very much a voice in what happens in their 6 cities and their departments. If we go to Stockton and we say we would like to see and try a few things, they have the option to say that we don't believe that will work in Stockton. And we will respect that. Just as we have done our 6 site visits, we've also met with numerous community groups, community organizations, and individuals. Respecting the work that is on the ground is key. And one of the things that we were very clear about is that we're not coming in to tell you that everything that you've been doing wrong, you've been doing everything wrong for the last 10 or 30 years, but we're either here to learn from you, to work with you, or to maybe even supplement some of those things that you've been doing. So what really makes this initiative different, and it really has a different feel, is one of sustainment. And I think that I know for me, and I would say for most of our partners as well, we recognize that by doing this work, we hope to leave what we've learned behind, and that you will just, again, as Tom has, again, so aptly put it, pass it on.
So let me stick with the substance that's been laid out so far for just a little while and then bring Priscilla in on the discussion in a moment. So Justice has said, and we are saying, that there are these 3 areas that offer concrete opportunities for cities and communities to make meaningful headway soon on the issue that
is probably foremost in all of our minds in policing and in these communities right now. So the three planks are procedural justice, implicit bias, and reconciliation work. So for Tom first and then for Tracie, what is in the portfolio now that cities can look to? Obviously we're giving special support to the National Initiative Cities, but lots of people are thinking about this and looking at it. What do we have to work with in procedural justice, and then Tracie, I'm going to say in implicit bias, that are actually concrete tools right now?
I think one tool that I feel very good about is training program. Early on, we, Tracie, Mears, and I worked with a group of people, and Bruce Lipman is actually here from the Chicago Police Department, to develop together a training program on procedural justice, which Bruce then took back to Chicago and worked with his training academy colleagues to improve. And actually, I thought they brought in a lot of interesting material from their experience with the officers to create a wonderful training program that's one day long. I know that Bruce is happy to work with people who are interested in hearing about that program or interested in doing that kind of training. Other jurisdictions, for example, Oakland, have already picked up on that, and I just learned that the NYPD have actually picked up on the Chicago training and are adapting it to their training academy. But the point is, it's an existing program that's been very well received by Chicago police officers that seems to meet the needs of lots of different jurisdictions that are interested in training. In Chicago, they are now doing procedural justice 2, since their officers have all done level 1. They developed a level 2, which has more new ideas for training about procedural justice. So eventually, if anyone wants to go to level 2, there is a level 2, and it's being rolled out in Chicago and tried out. They've been adapting it and changing it based upon the comments of the officers. And Bruce Lipman told me he's actually aspirationally focused on procedural justice 3. Now, he tried it out at Harvard Police Department and was excited about it. So the point is, we have existing programs that we think are very good. I also would point out that the COPS program, COPS office, has developed parallel programs that are also available for line officers, for sergeants, for chiefs. So there are several different kinds of programs that you could potentially look at. As part of the national initiative, we are going to try to develop two other aspects of an implementation package: written policies and practices for things like the use of force that we would recommend, and also policies and practices that can be rolled out by departments on the street. What we're doing is we're collecting information from different departments about different things that they have done to try to advance procedural justice in their community. One issue that often comes up as an example is dealing with social media, dealing with the media. So we have been working with chiefs who have proactively set up social media networks of their own and developed a relationship with the community through an ongoing interaction with people in the community about issues, so that when there is some particular crisis in the community, those chiefs have a network of people that trust them that they can send information to. That's an example of trying to build a collaborative relationship in advance of a problem. Policies and practices in one community, the community complained that when there was a shooting, they felt the police came into their community and basically took it over. After discussing this with the community and with the police, they revised their policy. Now, whenever there's a shooting, one senior commander goes into that area with the sole function of walking around and talking to everyone in the community, telling them what's happened, tell them what the police are doing, discuss with them anything they might know about the situation, any suggestions they might have about what the police should do. So just a couple of examples of what we hope will be a toolkit of a variety of different kinds of policies and practices that departments could consider.
Thanks, Tom. So, Tracie, Tracie, hang on for just a second. So we're in a really wonderful position on this. Where is Bruce Lipman? You want to tell us what this has felt like in Chicago?
What's your experience in Chicago doing this training?
The experience is there's a lot to talk about. We call it police legitimacy. We didn't want to call it by some other name, call it what we call it. We call it as police officers coming to the class or police legitimacy as they have said, police officers want to go, staff and training, come down the road, come to the board. They come to turn our poll at the beginning of the day. By the end of the day,
that's great, Bruce. Thanks. Yeah. And Danielle, are you here? So this has now moved to California, and you've put your own spin on it there. Tell us about that.
That's a strong mic. The training was received very well in both of those departments. It was reviewed as very good, excellent, or good by like 95% in Stockton, 98% in Oakland. So also very positively embraced. It was not viewed as corrective, and part of that was really thanks to the quality trainers that were selected and the leadership of the chiefs in the departments to indicate that this wasn't kind of a training business as usual, but really making it an initial step in changing policy and practice in departments. And so in Oakland and Stockton, both of those cities are now thinking about how do you go beyond training. And at the same time, David mentioned yesterday, Attorney General Kamala Harris's office has embraced this training, also with the addition of a module on implicit bias. And so there's a post-certified course on that that will begin in the fall for managers in California, but that is also viewed kind of as a first step in building access to the training for departments who want to take it in-house. So that would be followed by a train-the-trainer process, and then going in more depth with departments who want to use the training as a foundation for the types of policy and practice change that Tom mentioned.
Terrific, Daniel, thank you. So I'm going to dwell on this just a minute more, and then Tracie, give it to you. So one of the findings in the procedural justice literature is that, and Tom always, I don't have to tell you to feel free to correct me when I get this wrong, but one of these key findings is that remarkably small changes in behavior can either enhance or damage perceptions of legitimacy to a very high degree. And when I was with Bruce and his folks in the Chicago training, there was a moment that just burned itself into my memory, and it's kind of come to represent how powerful this stuff is. And the Chicago course is taught by police officers to police officers, and the teaching officer said to the room, and remember, this is an in-service training, it's not an academy module, these are seasoned officers, said to them, they hate us out there. I'm going to paraphrase it, but this is what they said. We don't get it, because we know why we went on the job, we know that we would literally take a bullet for the public, and they throw bottles at us, and they spit at us, and they won't talk to us, and they hate us, and we don't understand why. This makes no sense to us. And he said, so think about the last homicide scene you attended, and we're on our side of the crime tape, and there's a dead man on the ground, and maybe the forensics people are going over him, and the community's on the other side, and his family and his neighbors and the rest of the people who live in this area, they're looking across the crime scene tape at us, and what do they see us doing? Exactly. I've now asked this question a dozen times in different settings, and every time there are police officers in the room, this is the answer, because that's what police officers do. And I sat there in that room, and I am not a police officer, but I have been out there, and I realized to my utter shame, I've done it, right? Because this is what first responders do. Trauma doctors do it, you know, firefighters talk about crispy critters. You hope they don't do it when the dead folks' family's standing right there, right? But this is what people who deal with horror do to keep it at bay and to keep themselves healthy. And that room of officers, and honestly the rest of us, suddenly thought, in a community where people already think ill of the police, they sit there and they stand there and they watch the cops laugh over their dead. And Chicago police officers don't laugh over the dead people so much anymore. I mean, this is very, very basic stuff. And the research says it really matters, right? So this is one of the reasons we feel genuinely optimistic that we can do this work. Tracie.
Wonderful. And I'll just kind of tie into what Bruce and Tom were talking about. So other than the training in procedural justice, another portion of that, we call it a three-tier training, will be incorporating and actually tying together quite nicely procedural justice and implicit bias training. That is for us, which will be the third phase, which Bruce is working on, and those are the pieces that we'll be not offering only to the national initiative sites, but again, that will be something that'll be more than welcome and free to those that will want it. The Center for Policing Equity will also be doing a couple of things in each of the six sites. The first thing they'll be doing is a climate assessment. And one of the things that we have been acutely aware of, those of us who work in sort of the business of law enforcement, that all too often the voices of those on the ground, patrol officers and supervisors, are those that you don't hear really much from. You certainly will hear it from command staff and chiefs where it's also appropriate, but we don't go back and focus on the folks that are actually answering the 911 calls. I'm going to say this, with the exception of probably Chief Roper, who goes out there and answers those calls. Most chiefs do not. And so it's very important for the chiefs, the organizations, and the community to understand where they are situated. And so, you know, those questions, you know, also are pretty general. You know, what do you think of the department? What do you think of, you know, the direction if there is a specific initiative that's going on? What do you think of the community? What does the community think of you? So those are the pieces, that particular piece we'll be bringing to the table as far as the national initiative as well. A second part of a lot of the data gathering and survey work that'll be happening is an attitude matching behavior survey. This is a little different. This actually gets down to the individual level. We're trying to see if we can identify those behaviors that are favorable to having good interactions and relationships with communities, and are there some maybe outliers that chiefs can sort of kind of attune themselves to and begin to work with law enforcement with. It's a slightly longer survey that's done, but what we do with that information is we go back and we match it to performance measures. And for those of us who are cops in the room, first time hearing this, you just hear this gasp, right? What does that mean? You know, the union's not gonna let us do that. Of course, what we do with the individual attitude matching behavior, that's a very individualized, voluntary type of assessment. They not only volunteer to do that, they not only volunteer, you know, really quite knowing what they're agreeing to, but they're also getting paid for it. So that is the other piece that we bring. The final piece, and Tom again alluded to some of the work that will be happening, not just with Yale, but with CPE, is this policy review, this policy evaluation. One of the things that we have found out, and this has been in some of the work that's been done in some other police departments, is that policies often are written for good reasons, typically named after an individual who screwed that up, and we all know that person. But typically we'll have, in some cases, not all, we'll have disparate outcomes. So the example that I will use is the work that was done with Las Vegas Metro. Like most urban departments, Las Vegas Metro had and sees their share of foot chases. One of the things that they had noticed in their after-action reports and the data in which they collected is that there were a high number of use of force incidents that would occur after those foot chases. The results, of course, were very disparate depending on the community in which you were interacting with and the level to which that use of force would take place. In reviewing the policies with them and sitting down at the time with their sheriff and with their training and internal affairs, the suggestion was made, if at all possible, and those of us who've been in foot chases, Bruce, I know it's been a while for you, but for those of us who've been in foot chases, we know that the adrenaline is pumping, we are just focused on that individual, we are trying to get that person handcuffed. Las Vegas offered up an addition to that. When all things are safe and you are in a situation where you, being the primary chaser, do not have to put hands on, have your cover person do that for you. You simply get them contained, you stand by, you give those orders, you make sure that person is contained, and then your cover car walks up and handcuffs them. They saw their use of force after foot chases reduced by 23%. So sometimes it's not necessarily all in the training and all in the individual. Sometimes it's in those things we're asking them to do, and yet we don't come back to actually review and analyze, one, is it doing what we're asking it to do, or two, is it giving us something else that we really didn't want? So
implicit bias, procedural justice, and then the third plank is the one that John Jay and I personally are focusing on the most, which is this idea of reconciliation. And we've been very honest that it's the one of the three about which, at least in terms of direct application to American policing, we know the least. So there's a huge literature on both procedural justice and implicit bias. The literature on reconciliation in American policing is slim to non-existent, but we plan to fix that. So here's that story. And the centrality of this actually emerged, once again, from work that High Point, North Carolina, represented here, and we did together. So more than 10 years ago, when we took the first concrete attempt
to implementation, the first concrete work to shut down a drug market using these ideas. We had our faces rubbed in the fact that there were terrible, terrible, terrible narratives by the community about the police and by the police about the community. And you all know this. If you went to the community, they said, everybody knows the CIA invented crack, the cops could stop it if they wanted to, but they don't want to. They let it in or they bring it in because they need us selling drugs so they can arrest our sons and put them in jail and prison, and otherwise they wouldn't have any work to do and there would be no union wage jobs for the cracker prison guards upstate. And they are doing this to us on purpose and because they want to. And you would sit down with narcotics officers and they would say, everybody knows what's going on, nobody will tell us, everybody's living off drug money. And if you spent time with the community and if you spent time with police officers, you knew from your own direct experience, this was not sophisticated. Neither one of those things were right. The CIA was, the police were not conspiring with the CIA to bring crack to the neighborhoods. And in fact, almost nobody was living off drug money, including the drug dealers, right, who were broke and living with their mothers. But the narratives were really strong. And in order to do the drug market work, we had to deal with it. And we actually, at that time, thought about that as a small but real reconciliation process. And Jim Faley, who was Marty Sumner's boss at the time, went to the West End in High Point and stood in a community room and said to the people there, I'm sorry, we have failed you. It hasn't worked, we know it hasn't worked. We've swept through your neighborhood and turned your sons upside down and seen if crack fell out of their pockets, and if it did, we took them away, and if it didn't, we sent them on their way. And we have stood next to the tables full of guns and drugs and money and declared victory and moved on out, and 2 weeks later, it's as if we never did it. It hasn't worked, it's done damage, we have been disrespectful. I'm sorry, we have failed you, but we have a different thing we'd like to try, and we can only do it with you, and can we talk about that? And Jim Summey was in that room, and to this day says, we were gonna take his head off. We hadn't had a police chief in front of us for 10 years. We were loaded for bear. And he said what he said, and we looked at each other and said, well, okay, now what do we do, right? And what that meant was that Jim could then say to the community, and I will never forget this phrase, I can't care more about your neighborhood than you do. If you don't do your part, which includes at least making sure that those on the corners know that you don't approve of it, we can't represent your norms for you. Nobody can set standards for your neighborhood from the outside. And the community looked at each other and said, that's right. I've been in dozens of these meetings now, and every single time somebody says, our parents and grandparents would never have put up with this. He's right. This is our responsibility. So in a very small way, we know that one can do reconciliation work. And one can do it, not fix everything, but at least one creates the ground on which one can move forward with some, common ground. And it is transformative. What we have not done and don't know how to do and are thinking about now is how does one take that to, say, a city scale? Not talking about reconciliation for the United States, but how do we do this in Birmingham? And we have been talking and thinking about this a lot and have some ideas, but in this we've been getting help from Priscilla. And Priscilla will tell you a little bit about what she's done. Priscilla is one of the leading international figures in large-scale truth and reconciliation work, as in South Africa. And she's been sitting with us and schooling us on this, and what do you think?
Thank you, David. Thank you very much. First, let me say what an absolute pleasure and honor it's been to be here yesterday and today. I'm learning a lot, and I've been very impressed with all that I've heard. And I should also start with perhaps two caveats. One is that I don't speak for the National Initiative. I'm advising them where I can be helpful. But what I'm intending to do here is to put ideas on the table. But those are ideas for exploration. As David said, the whole program and the National Initiative is still being explored and developed. And I think this issue is particularly challenging one. The second caveat is linked to that, which is that when I travel quite a bit internationally and I'm asked to speak to various civil society groups, governments, and others that have all good intentions to put in place justice programs and reconciliation programs in contexts of transition, post-apartheid, post-dictatorship, post-civil war, I usually start by saying, I can bring ideas, I can give you examples from other places, but I don't know your context, I don't know your realities, and you have to listen and work out whether any of this is useful to you. So even though I actually come from the United States, I'm gonna say the same thing here because it still stands. All of you here have a sense of these issues, a very close sense of these issues, and you can work out whether any of these kinds of ideas are useful or not. It's really a process still of brainstorming and trying to learn what we can from the many attempts to work on issues around reconciliation, writ broadly, in many, many different contexts around the world. I should start also by saying that I find reconciliation as a term and as a concept very challenging. Many places where I go, you know, Colombia and the peace process that's underway currently, South Africa after apartheid with the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, Thailand, which is trying to work itself out of a military regime right now, and framing part of that very much around a concept of reconciliation. The word reconciliation and the desire for reconciliation comes up almost everywhere. It means different things to different people, and therefore I always start a little bit unsure what people are intending by it, and I have to say also that I find in many of these contexts that the victims' organizations, the victims' groups, the victims themselves, those communities that feel most damaged by whatever regime or situation they're coming out of, they often are very nervous about the word reconciliation because the last thing they want is a process which is essentially saying, let's forget about the past and let's sort of just get along now. Let's turn the page and look to the future and we don't really have to think about those hard things that happened. That doesn't fly. And so people are, when they hear policymakers framing programs around reconciliation, I have often seen in many other contexts that the first response is a bit skepticism and nervousness. And I do feel firmly that although it's obviously a positive goal, we need to build any program of reconciliation around very concrete and real programs and ends. It's not just let's all feel good, but it's actually how are we going to address this? So I would propose a few sort of principles and a few specific programming ideas based on what I've gleaned from others' experiences. One is that I think when we think about reconciliation, we should be sure to not think of it as an end point, but as a process that we enter into. It's not a place one arrives, but it's a road that one is traveling on. It takes hard work, and it's a program, usually a reflection and understanding that continues into the future. And unfortunately, this is one thing that Archbishop Desmond Tutu in South Africa emphasized when they set up their Truth and Reconciliation Commission. Everybody expected and was so happy that within a few years when the Truth Commission ended, they would all be reconciled. And at the end of the few years, they realized they weren't reconciled really at all, although they had done some important things and gone through a lot of very tough truth-telling. And that's when Desmond Tutu said, actually, reconciliation is a process. It's something that we will always be working on. It's not something that we can achieve through the process, through the work of one commission. And I think that's something that's important to remember. So what would I suggest as elements of a sort of programmatic approach to reconciliation? One is that I think something that is fairly universal is usually it suggests the need, the desire for reconciliation suggests the need to better understand one another. To understand what has happened, what is still happening, where we come from, what the truths are in our society, and also what the perceptions of the truths are as in our society, as David has laid out in some of the examples he's described. That is something that's actually hard work. There's not one way to do that. We can be creative about how one gets to the truth. But I do think it's very important that it has to be based on a process of listening, of engaging honestly, of looking at some really hard truths, be that historical or present day. It has to be a process by which we recognize that our realities and our understanding may be different, but there are usually some truths that we can agree to. Now, I have often seen in some countries that people say, oh, you know, we don't really need a truth process because we sort of already know what's happened. And I then see that as they have often do decide to go through a process, through a formal truth, national truth commission or other kind of process, that at the end of that, the same people are saying, we had no idea. If we only knew. There's things that we thought we knew that we didn't fully understand. There's things that maybe we had an inkling of, but we couldn't fully directly address. I wouldn't necessarily suggest that a truth process, if one were to do something here or in specific cities or communities here, will look like what we've seen in any other context. I actually see this developing many different ways in different places. In particular, I'm not necessarily suggesting there should be a truth commission. I've worked around and studied truth commissions in dozens of countries around the world, and there's advantages and disadvantages. It's essentially a sort of a blue ribbon panel with a large staff, a large budget, and considerable powers to really look into, to talk to lots and lots of people, take testimony from many people, look into what's happened, come out with a report and make recommendations. That can be very effective. That's not necessarily the right model for here. We can think creatively about how to collect narratives, how to speak with people, how to record that, how to engage across groups and communities in different places at different times. That's something that I think is open as to how one does this. I personally think that some process of looking at, honestly, at truths in our society is necessary. I think it could be useful in this particular context between law enforcement and communities, and probably in other broader contexts around race more generally in our society. When one then comes to a place or is in the process of still collecting information and getting to truths, then what does one do with that? And I think two steps remain. One is that it can be very powerful to have a process of acknowledging that truth by whatever appropriate authority is at that place. There's a sort of distinction we have in the field of transitional justice where I work, where people say the difference between knowledge and acknowledgement is very powerful. And if one acknowledges and states these things that perhaps maybe were somewhat known, they have become better clarified, better understood, it's a form of respect, it's a form of recognition as to what has happened. So the process of acknowledging these difficult truths, the difficult history behind these truths can be very important and powerful. And then secondly, what does one do on a more programmatic basis with that information? And of course, in some contexts, it's a question of justice for wrongdoers and reparations for victims. Now, whether those concepts in here directly translate, we could think about. But I think the third of those is quite relevant, which is what kinds of changes need to take place based on what one has learned. What kinds of reforms, taking into account what Tracie has said about, you know, people can be nervous about reforms done to you. But usually there are changes that should come out of whatever processes one has gone through to reflect what one has learned, to respect what one has learned, and to make sure, most importantly, that this is not whatever these actions or behaviors or misunderstandings will not happen again in the future. What's been interesting to me, to just perhaps as my last comment, is to reflect on, after listening into so many fascinating conversations yesterday, is that how much there is clearly a commitment to some of the changes and reforms that have been done in quite remarkable ways by all of you. And so that those steps are already being taken in a way that one often does not see in the places where I have been working. So I think that obviously the positive steps are already beginning, but I wonder if those will be fully grounded without being able to also address somehow, listen to, address, and understand the truths of the matter behind those relationships. Thank you very much.
Thank you. So let me say one thing on top of that and then open it up. And that is that there's a very, very clear pattern emerging in the National Initiative cities and actually in all the other places where we're doing anything remotely like this, which is that when one goes to law enforcement, particularly police agencies, and says we are committed to these ideas of procedural justice and right treatment, and we're going to acknowledge that we have arguably done wrong with respect to the community and we're going to do better, the next thing somebody says is, well, we don't treat people very well inside this agency either, and when are we going to start treating each other with respect? And the procedural justice and reconciliation conversation with respect to police community relations is seemingly inevitably sparking reflection about the way our own organizations are managed and treat each other. And not quite sure where that's going to go either, but it is very powerful. So we've got a few minutes. Over to you. Thoughts, questions, anything?
First of all, I'm Maria Beam, and I work with the National Legal Aid and Defender Association. And congratulations to OJP for putting together this really comprehensive approach to a big problem, a big issue. So my comment is basically that, yes, I work on the defender side. And I realize we work in an adversarial system of justice, but it's also a system, justice system. And I think that we all share in this room the same goals of better outcomes for individuals, families, communities. And I just wondered if, you mentioned you're putting together the six cities, you're putting together courts, judges, prosecutors involved, and I wonder if there's any defense voice in all of this, because I think they bring an important voice to the table with their clients every day, bring them stories of what's going on out in the real world. And I'm very grateful for your work, Tom Tyler's work, David Kennedy's work. It's really important stuff. And I just wondered if there is a defense voice in any of the work that you're doing in the NI.
There is. So let me just say yes. That's been true in our thinking, and it was my mistake to leave that out because it belongs there. We agree with you. It's very important. There's representation in our kind of advisory and innovation structure on this. The answer is yes. In the most practical terms, one thing that we'll be looking for is particular sites in which we can go deeper and do particular additional pieces of work. And so one real possibility would be that in one of the existing six sites, we make a special effort to work with the defense bar and honestly, like all the rest of this, figure out what's possible there and where this can go, but yes.
I think it's also an important point that comes out of your comment that even though policing is the focus of a lot of our discussion, this initiative is not only about policing, it's about the entire criminal justice system and the experience of that system in the different cities.
Miller?
Hello, Tony Gross. Few things. One, I'll start with some semantics. Recently, the gun task force, the gang unit, or the jump out boys were suspended in Providence because of a verbal altercation they had with a working child of a community leader. We brought them back into a party, a fundraiser of ours, but we also changed their name. I suggested we call them the unit, the mothers can sleep well at night, unit, right? We sometimes forgot the purpose of these aggressive units. And they love the, you're telling me zeros? Okay. So the semantics, I think, sometimes matter. I lived in London for 2 years where cops were considered public servants. So just semantics. Usually I'm not big on semantics, but I think it's repurposes. I'm worried about our mature democracy not being open for reconciliation. We have our camps pretty set up. We have skirmishes just now, you know, the Confederacy flag in South Carolina. But really, it's not like we're emerging out of like apartheid where there's such a dramatic change. So I want you to talk a little bit about how do you do reconciliation in a mature democracy. And the other thing I think we often, and I don't necessarily intend to give an exit valve now to the police, but I think going to Guillermo's favorite idea of triangles. We have police, we have minority communities, and we have white society. I think the setup white society created with police and black community is problematic. So it's not all hinges on police. We really created garbage cleaners. They go and contain the most difficult environments. We don't want this to come to our suburbs, these problems. So we send the police into these horrible confrontations. And just thinking of police and minority communities sorting it out, or it's all on the police, I think we are not articulating enough what's the role of white society at large in resetting this relationship of policing.
Thanks, Tony. When I was at the Kennedy School, the dean had three boxes on his desk. It was in, out, and too hard. So I'm really pleased that our time is up. Tenny does a wonderful job of keeping us honest, God damn it. So thanks a lot. And thank the panel, thank all of you, and on to the rest of the day.
Thank you for joining us at this morning's plenary session. The next round of panels begins at 11:30 a.m. Panel session in L.61 is titled Using Social Network Analysis and Social Media Tools for Crime Prevention. Room L.63, the panel is titled New Areas of Promise, Prosecution, Prisons, and Community Supervision. And finally, Room 9.64, the panel is titled Applying the Domestic Violence in Intervention. Thank you.